Before I start, I just want to extend a really big thank you to our From the Field sponsors of this webinar, to Kathy and Rick Fox. Thanks so much for your support of this webinar. If anybody on this call is interested in learning more about sponsoring one of our webinars in the future, please contact Kate Fitzwilliams. Her contact details are there, but I am going to bring them up again at the end of the presentation. So if you don't manage to catch them now, please get a pen and paper ready and you can catch them at the end of them as well. So with that, I'm going to kick off with today's webinar, and it's really looking at Africa's iconic crown cranes, securing their future in the wild. And this is a project that has been run and coordinated under a partnership between the International Crane Foundation and the Endangered Wildlife Trust. I think most of you on this call are probably aware of the International Crane Foundation, an NGO based over in Baraboo in Wisconsin in the United States, focused on conserving cranes around the world. And the Endangered Wildlife Trust is an NGO based in South Africa, but working on conservation projects across both Southern and East Africa. And it's really a fantastic partnership where it brings together the African perspective and the international perspective that I think really gives us a leading edge in the work that we actually do across the continent. So before I start, I want to give a quick introduction to who I am. So I think as you're all aware, I'm Karen Morrison. I'm Vice President International, Director of Africa for the International Crane Foundation, and I oversee the partnership in conservation. It's all I've ever wanted to do. And I think in my earlier years, I was really interested in looking at the large predators in Africa, the lions, leopards, cheetahs, wild dogs, and working inside of protected areas and national parks. And I was very lucky enough to be able to get involved in a short project researching them during my university years. And it wasn't very long after starting that project that I realized that predators spend a lot of time somewhere else. And it was at that time that my interest was starting to peak in community-based conservation and exploring conservation outside of protected areas. So I started exploring that avenue, looking for something that would really keep me interested and intrigued. And I was offered a master's project working with landowners in the Dullstroom area in South Africa in 1995. And it seemed to me to be the ideal project. I could identify a crane. I didn't know much about any other birds and could barely differentiate between a sparrow and a dove at that point. But I at least could identify a crane, conservation elements together on that. And the rest they really say is history. And I've had an amazing journey with cranes since 1995. Cranes have taken me all over the world to the most amazing places. I've met the most amazing people on all corners of the earth. And I've been involved with incredible conservation projects that involve cranes in one or other way. Yes, it's involved the research of cranes, but it's included wetland conservation, included catchment management, carbon trading, and incorporating people into conservation solutions. So most of our work happens outside of protected areas or outside of national parks, where we really explore and look for a way that we can find the balance between cranes and people on the same land. So really looking at ways to benefit people and cranes. And I must be honest, since then, after having started with only just being able to identify a crane, I can admit that I am a fully addicted craniac. They are an amazing species that I just absolutely love. And I just cannot imagine my life without cranes in it. And I think that there are many people on the call today who probably feel some pressure to them in the field, the more you attach to them. So moving then on to the cranes themselves. I'm gonna be chatting today, as I said, on our two crane species, our gray-crowned and our black-crowned cranes. And they are truly iconic and charismatic species. They are just absolutely gorgeous and beautiful. They are icons of the grasslands across Africa and are icons of our savannas, whether our open savannas or closed in almost wooded or open canopy forest areas. Our black and grey crowned cranes are the only two of our 15 crane species that are able to perch in trees. And that is due to their long hind toe that allows them to actually grip a branch and be able to perch in trees or on pylons. But we often see cranes associated with our wildlife across Africa as well. But cranes too are flagships for biodiversity that we find in our agricultural systems. And grey-crowned cranes in particular are often seen in agricultural landscapes. Our black-crowned cranes are icons of our Sahelian north of Africa and our deltas in the far western parts of West Africa. But cranes are known for their incredible, elaborate pair dances, and I think it's very often these dances that capture the hearts and the minds of so many people, where their beauty is just really magnified when they're out in the wild. And I've been speaking to so many people, it's these pair dances and the dances that they have as part of a flock, whether it be a threat display or whether it be part of a pair bonding activity, that has really captured people in the world. But it's also their booming calls. Grey crowned cranes and black crowned cranes have the most amazing booming calls that help the pair to strengthen the bond between them. Crown cranes, both black and grey crowned, can raise the largest families of any of the crane species and will raise anything up to 4 chicks in a season at a time. And they're incredible parents where both the male and the female play a very strong role in raising chicks and looking after them. At the end of the breeding season, though, they come together in these amazing flocks. Several black Western Ethiopia and in Chad. So they come together with amazing the to watch, but very often in very close association with people and livestock and the activities that with people. So you very often find both black and grey crown cranes associated with people. But it's their call that makes them so distinctive, I think, to so many people. And the grey crown crane in particular has a very distinctive call, and it really is what gives it its local name in many places in Africa. So in South Africa, they are called in Afrikaans Mahem, which mimics in a way, or it sort of mimics it, the call of the grey crown crane. And in East Africa, they've got a slightly different dialect, I suppose, because they're a one in the local language there. So that's very characteristic when they fly, and amazing to hear them calling as they fly across our grasslands and savanna regions. Getting a little bit more serious now and a little bit onto what grey-crowned cranes are all about. Our grey-crowned cranes are found across East and Southern Africa. They are currently classified as endangered and are one of the fastest declining, if not the fastest declining crane species in the world. They've declined by anything up to 80% across large parts of their range in Africa. And it's due primarily to three key reasons. The first is habitat loss. As with most other crane species, grey crown cranes are dependent on wetlands for breeding and for raising chicks. And there's a huge encroachment into wetlands by agriculture, also for mining purposes and eucalyptus plantations or tree plantations. But largely it's the encroachment of agriculture into these wetland habitats, very often extending right the way. The second key threat is that of disturbance, and that's by both people and livestock. And the reason that this is a threat is that cranes spend more time watching the disturbance than they actually do tending eggs or incubating eggs or caring for chicks, which results in a lower breeding productivity in that area. And then the third reason for that decline is the illegal trade or the illegal removal of crane chicks from the wild. And these three factors, the habitat loss and degradation, the and disturbance, your habitat areas, your suitable wetland nesting areas get smaller and smaller as agriculture encroaches into your wetlands. So you get more and more human disturbance, and crane nests are much easier to see and to find, and crane chicks are much easier to find, which means that the opportunistic removal of crane chicks from these wetlands increases. So these three factors that are the key reason for the decline really work with each other and have caused some frightening declines in many parts of Africa. The second species is black crown cranes, and they're very similar in many respects to grey crown cranes, but so different in so many other respects. They are found across the Sahel in Africa, so just south of the Sahara Desert. It's an incredibly hot area. And they used to be found across an almost contiguous range across the Sahel. But over time, this range has been fragmented more and more. And this is where we now find the black crown cranes. And some parts of it, we are not even sure if they are still there. Unfortunately, large parts of their range we cannot access, and we don't have information on due to insurgent control, for example, Boko Haram or ISIS, or civil unrest like we have in the Darfur region in South Sudan. So large parts of the range we cannot access. We've realized that the black crown crane is the crane species we probably know least about in the world. And it's currently classified as vulnerable, but it really is a question as to what is happening their status across the range. But the two key reasons for their decline and threat has been, the first one is increased aridity and prolonged droughts and decrease in the availability of water. But secondly, the illegal removal of crane chicks from the wild for captivity. But the focus of this presentation is really on the crowned crane trade. And I'm going to run through a little bit about why crowned cranes are in trade, then a little bit about some of the information that we know, followed by what we have done to date. And then I'm going to end off with some of our challenges our steps are. So I'm going to walk through a little bit about our crowned crane trade work that we've been involved with since about 1997. So I'm going to start with what we know about the crowned crane trade. And as I spoke about right at the beginning and showed those beautiful photos of crowned cranes, cranes are incredibly charismatic, they're beautiful, they're iconic, people love them, they're really beautiful, and they really add a lot of value. People like watching them, they like seeing them, and people want to see them. I think for me, of all species in the world, crowned cranes are the one that people do associate with Africa, hence they have situations, and this includes in zoos where they are held on display just for their beauty and for people to see. Very often they add value to savanna exhibits where they're in mixed exhibits with other hoof stock, for example with kudu or bushbuck or other African ungulates that are there with them. They're also collected by private breeders or are just kept in captivity around the world. And they're used in flight shows in many zoos and captive facilities across the world, very often displaying excellently their calls as they fly. But they're also kept in gardens, alongside restaurants, and in homesteads in many parts of Africa, and particularly around homesteads. Cranes are taken on as pets. They're also fantastic watchdogs. They are territorial in nature, so they will tend to keep people and other animals out. But they're also great alarm clocks because they tend to boom every morning just before dawn. So it gives people an indication of when it's 6 a.m. in the morning. So they really are great alarm clocks for people to have. So in the the early 2000s, we were starting to get a lot of reports, probably like 1990s, early 2000s. We started getting reports from around the world from a number of people about the concern about the illegal crane trade and keeping of cranes in captivity. But we really didn't understand at that stage whether it was a couple of incidents that a lot of people knew about, or whether it really was as big a problem or was a concern that we really needed to address. So in the early 2000s to about 2005, we did a series of rapid assessments in a number of countries, and the stars are where we looked at the crane trade initially, just to get a sense of whether it was a problem, what was happening, and just to try and get an idea of what we were looking at and how to address it. So we started in these countries. Unfortunately, we've stopped and started on this project a little bit, but over time we've deepened our knowledge in some of these countries. We've got information from additional countries across Africa. So we're building on the picture that we developed then, but realizing that it's an ever-changing landscape. Some key statistics that came out of those early studies that we wild actually died before they reached the capital city of Bamako. So that's before they were even exported internationally, if that was where they were going, or if they were going into domestication somewhere else. So it just showed us the large number of chicks that were actually dying for the few birds that would end up in captivity on the other side. Of all the people that were interviewed across those various studies, 93% of people knew that cranes were being taken out of the wild. And the people that we spoke to were all local community members. They were people who lived in the same landscapes that cranes were found in. And 93% of them knew that cranes were being taken out of the wild. In most countries, people knew that the removal from the wild was illegal. Rwanda was the only exception in that, and I'm going to go into Rwanda a little bit later, so I'll explain what happened there. But in every other country, people knew that it was illegal. The one thing that was surprising for us that we didn't expect is that it was very clear from everybody that we spoke to that it was individuals that benefited. It was not a community. So the removal of crane chicks from the wild was not a community activity. It was usually one individual or one family in a community that was involved in the activity. And the other thing that was clear is that there were very much organized trade routes in each of the countries where we explored the crane trade. Yes, there was opportunism, but definitely trade routes that were organized in each of the areas. So it was an organized crime activity. In terms of domestication, and how we defined this really was where cranes were being kept around homesteads, they were being kept in gardens, or potentially around in hotels or at restaurants. So they weren't being kept in a captive facility per se, but rather where they were kept as pets. That's how we defined domestication. What we found in Mali is that there were more cranes in domestication than there were in the wild. In Rwanda, we had more than 40% of the total population of grey crown cranes in that country were actually in domesticated situations. And very recently, we're starting to hear more and more reports about a large number of cranes being kept in domesticated situations in the Democratic Republic of Congo. We haven't been in there to look at this, so they are unsubstantiated at the moment, but the reports are increasing out of the DRC that there's increasing levels of domestication. We also looked into the captive populations around the world, and And this is it, this was particularly interesting. And I think the key thing here to realize, and I know that these figures are a little bit outdated and they will have changed by now, but 10 to 15 years ago, there were probably about, there was an estimated 12,000 captive facilities around the world. Of those, only 1,200 or 10% actually belonged to organized regional zoo associations. So we had a number of zoo associations around the world. For example, the Association of Zoos Aquaria in the United States, the African Association of Zoos and Aquaria in Africa. And within these zoo associations, zoos can become members, but they are then required to meet minimum requirements for keeping. So it's the other 90% of captive facilities around the world that are not organized in any way and are not in groups of, are not grouped in any way, that are really difficult to reach. So in the rapid assessment that we did initially, I just looked at zoos and at a very much a random sample within the zoo associations. And we found a couple of things. The first thing was that the captive populations of gray and black zoo associations, there were usually quite high mortality rates and low breeding success of the crown cranes. And the reason for the high mortality rates and the low breeding success was due to the fact that they were often kept in open air exhibits. So in other words, they weren't in a fully closed in enclosure, but an open air exhibit where predation was more prevalent, and very often mixed exhibits with other hoof stock. So there was a greater chance of being trampled potentially by a kudu or another antelope species. And then we looked at the CITES database. CITES is the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species of Wild Fauna and Flora. It's a multilateral agreement that many countries around the world are signatories to. I'm sure many of you have heard of CITES, especially with regards to ivory and rhino horn. And I know shark fin are very up in under discussion, and some of the fish species. But CITES really looks at, it's a monitoring tool really, and tries to guide trade. It's international, and it's linked to international legal trade around the world. So, and its real aim is to ensure that the international trade in specimens of wild plants and animals does not threaten their survival. So acknowledging that there will be legal trade in species, but so long as it doesn't, what CITES does is make sure that it doesn't threat, that trade isn't a key contributor to their decline or threat. When we looked at the CITES database and just what it was telling us about cranes, we found a number of concerning things. The first thing is that many records do not have any information on the origin. So in other words, whether the cranes were captive bred or whether they were wild caught. Index 2, which is the particular category that cranes are usually in, you don't need an import and an export permit, but many people did submit import and export permits, and those very seldom matched. So there were a lot of inconsistencies. We dug a little bit deeper at that time because we realized that there were large numbers, a couple hundred black crown cranes going out of Sudan on CITES permit over, you know, each year. And when we investigated this a little bit further, we found out at that time that only 12% of the birds going, of the cranes going out on CITES, only 12% of the cranes actually being exported out of Sudan at that time actually had a CITES permit. So the level of trade in cranes was much higher than what we had in the CITES database. But I do need to highlight here that CITES only monitors legal international trade. So a lot of questions that were raised for us, and it did raise a lot of alarm bells that The trading cranes was a lot higher than what we expected. And then in terms of trade movements, and this is a band, one that's really difficult to keep on top of. And I think, you know, if we look at the demand side for cranes, we know that they're going into captivity. But in the 1970s, 1980s, the United States and Europe were the key domains. So most of the trade out of Africa was going across to Europe and the US. However, on CITES, very few cranes are now going into Europe and into the US. And it seems that that trade has now changed and the demand has changed and has moved across to the Middle and Far East. Looks like there is a demand for them in the safari parks and water parks across the Far East, but that is something that we need to explore a little bit more. But we also know that these market chains move and the actual market chains or trade routes change over time. Mali, for instance, was a key conduit for trade out of West Africa into the rest of the world for a long time. But it shifted across to Guinea for a number of years, and we're starting to see a shift back into Mali again for the trade into the rest of the world. What is concerning is that when you do find these hubs move, they are, so for example, in Mali, we know now that a number of black crown cranes have been traded out of Mali on CITES permit over the last couple of years. But the number of birds that are leaving Mali on CITES permits doesn't make sense because we know that the country doesn't have the number of birds available in the wild to be able to be exporting that number. So we strongly suspect that birds are being siphoned in from other countries in West Africa and then moving out through Mali. And these trade points or exit points out of Africa do change depending on where law enforcement is strongest and how conservation efforts move and adapt. And traders adapt at the same time. We also know that there is cross-border trade. We know that there used to be quite a lot of trade into Rwanda. That has decreased, but we've now started picking up more trade between Uganda and into Rwanda. So you've constantly got this movement and changing of trade markets as traders adapt, as the demand changes, and really is very dependent where conservation efforts are strong and where it's getting too hot for illegal trade to happen. So it's about being on top of this the whole time and trying to just understand how it's moving so that you one step ahead, which is really hard. So what have we been doing since the early 2000s on the crane trade? I think one of the activities we did that has really had the most impact was a motion that was endorsed at the IUCN World Conservation Union, the International Union for the Conservation of Nature, and it brings together thousands of conservationists from around the world, including people from NGOs, from the government sector, from research institutions, and individuals who are just interested in species conservation. The motion was aimed at minimizing the trade in wild caught cranes. And we recommended in the motion for countries around the world to refuse wild caught imports, to verify the legal status of all trade, facilities combine efforts to maintain viable captive populations, both regionally and internationally. We asked for the improvement of the CITES trade database and that more stringent controls be put in place where non-compliance was an issue, and for the CITES Secretariat to conduct a significant trade review for all African crane species. Now, give me a second. The CITES significant trade review process is a process whereby if a species is added to the SIG trade review process, countries have to prove that any legal trade in that species is not having a detrimental impact to the wild population. And it's incredibly important. And we were very, very pleased in 2009 to have both black and crown cranes included in the SIG trade review process. So this started with a moratorium on trade across East and Southern Africa, across the range states where gray and black crown cranes were found. And as countries could prove that, number one, they either had no legal trade in cranes, or that there was no trade in cranes, or any trade was not having a detrimental impact on wild populations, they were taken off that list. So in 2019, we landed up with four species on that list, four countries, Tanzania, Sudan, South Sudan, and Guinea. And it was those four countries that there was a moratorium on trade, and that before any further legal trade could happen out of those countries, they first had to prove that that trade would not have a detrimental impact on the species, number one, and number two, that they could monitor any trade if it were allowed effectively. In 2019, Mali was added to that list for reasons I mentioned earlier. CITES started realizing that the number of cranes being exported on CITES permit out of Mali was starting to increase, and investigating a little bit further, there were concerns about where those birds were coming from. And hence, Mali was added to that list of countries in 2019. However, black crown cranes were then uplisted to Appendix 1 on CITES monitoring or the highest level of control in CITES. It requires a very clear import and export permit and clear reasons for any trade in a species that's on Appendix 1. So as a result of that, black crown cranes are no longer on the SIG trade review process, under the assumption that being an Appendix 1 species, they will now, trade is a lot more strongly controlled under Appendix 1. Grey crown cranes are still under Appendix 2 on CITES. Moving on to the viable and sustainable captive populations, and I really want to thank Claire Mirandi, who is behind the scenes on this webinar, answering some of your questions that are coming in already, who really helped me in this particular project in looking at how we could develop viable captive populations around the world. And we've worked extensively with zoo associations on each of the various continents where large numbers of gray and black crown cranes are being held, encouraging those zoo associations to develop stud books, to ensure that husbandry practices are good, and to just really work towards viable captive populations, negating the need for any wild caught birds to go into zoos in those associations. And I want to say, really shout out especially to the Chinese Association of Zoo Gardens, and this on very seriously, and are working hard to develop good stud books and good systems for both black and grey crown cranes to make sure that in the future there are viable captive populations. And I want to just chat a little bit about Rwanda and what has happened there. I mentioned a little bit earlier in some of in our findings that 40% of Rwanda's grey crown crane population as a whole in the country were in domestication when we explored it at that time. The Wildlife Conservation Association, in collaboration with the Rwanda Development Board, really set out to mitigate this threat and have done the most amazing job in Rwanda of addressing this threat and minimizing it. They started off with an awareness campaign, just increasing the awareness and making everybody aware that it was actually illegal to keep cranes in captivity. Something, as I mentioned earlier, many people in Rwanda were not aware of. So They then developed a database of bringing them into quarantine, making sure they've been through the proper health checks, and that those that are able to are then returned to the wild at Akagera National Park, where a number of them have started breeding already. And those that cannot go back to the wild have now been moved to the Imisambi village, which the Rwanda Wildlife Conservation Association has set up, where they can now actually live out an existence in a really good environment where they are well cared for. And finally, we've been involved on the ground with a number of communities and a number of projects where we know that cranes are being taken out of the wild. And Uganda is one where we have increased knowledge and increased awareness amongst community members about the illegal nature of trade. And we have empowered champions to become crane custodians to watch over our cranes in their area, and to play a bit of a watchdog role to ensure that they are not taken out of the wild. And this has had large successes across a number of our community-based projects in Africa. So what have our challenges been, and what lessons can we draw from COVID-19 as we start moving forward? I know one of the biggest challenges and one of the biggest frustrations for me has been the absolute focus of the world on the rhino poaching and elephant poaching. This is really, absolutely a Tasmanian, but it's been to the detriment of so many other species. When we were starting to gain traction on the crane trade just over a decade ago, but when rhino and elephant poaching started coming to the fore, it was absolutely impossible to get any law enforcement agency anywhere in Africa to respond to to any incident where we knew that cranes were being traded illegally, just because all the capacity in Africa when it came to wildlife law enforcement was focused on rhinos and elephants. And what that did mean, and I've had this, and unfortunately I don't have figures, but a lot of the informants that I've had over the years have highlighted very clearly for me that it's been an incredible win for traders in smaller wildlife and in live trade, because nobody has been focusing on that. So some people have even told me that it's now higher than it was in the 1970s and 80s. Whether it is or not, I'm not sure, because people have said to me that the trade in wild animals has increased significantly because there just hasn't been law enforcement to address it. Borders across Africa are porous, we know that. But what we also know from customs officials is that they're aware that cranes are being traded across borders. They are of it. Cranes are tied in many ways, because if they confiscate them, they have to keep those cranes alive at the borders until the court case has been heard and skills. So there's a real need there to try and find a way to overcome barrier to law enforcement. And then, as I was saying earlier, the other challenge is the private captive facilities that we have around the world, which are about 90% of the captive facilities that we have. How do we reach those? How do we reach those people to increase awareness and to try and encourage more of a coordinated and cooperative approach to ensuring that captive populations are the coronavirus? So it is a zoonotic disease, which means that it's a disease that spreads between animals and people. And it's changed a lot of our thought processes and ideas around the world. The coronavirus is a disease that spread, or is an organism that spread, from bats across to pangolins and then to people, and hence being a zoonotic disease. What is very interesting is that 60 to 70% of all diseases that since 1999 that have been found in people are actually zoonoses, 60 to 70% of all new diseases. And that includes things that we're very well aware of. Things like, for example, Ebola, Salmonella, HIV, Lyme's disease, rabies, swine flu, and the list goes on and on. And these are not going to be the only ones. As we move forward into the future, more zoonotic diseases are going to be found in people, and people are going to transfer diseases to wildlife and to animals as well. And there are predictions that in the future, we will find some of these zoonotic diseases to be far more detrimental to people than what COVID-19 is at the moment. But a lot of these disease, so a lot of the focus right now under COVID-19 has been on the wet market and on the bushmeat trade, largely because that's where COVID-19 supposedly originated. And these wet markets are areas where you can get food, produce, so meat and fish and other animal products. And that's why the focus has really been on the wet markets and bushmeat trade. However, one does wonder whether there will be any focus or discussion around the live trade. Zoonoses have spread not only from eating of animals and wildlife, but also from the close association that people have with animals and wildlife. So it's not out of the question that people could pick up a zoonotic disease in the live trade of animals. Zoonotic diseases and the movement of zoonotic diseases between animals and people increases as there is an increasing contact between animals and people. And this is largely linked to things like the loss of habitat in areas, agricultural intensification, and the expanding agricultural frontier. And it's just, this is a reality that we're living with. And it's as people come more into contact with wildlife, especially animals like bats and rodents, but a large number of other wildlife, there is an increasing opportunity and risk for zoonotic diseases to move from wildlife and animals into people. What is interesting is that a study done a couple of years ago actually identified East Africa as a high-risk area for zoonotic diseases to establish and to emerge, due to the high species diversity that we have in East Africa, linked closely to very high human population densities at lower latitudes, which means that you've got the right temperatures and the right weather conditions for that to happen. But also during this time, CITES has come under scrutiny, and there's a lot of discussion around where CITES is going to go. As I've mentioned a couple of times during this talk, CITES deals with international legal trade. It does not deal at the moment with the welfare and health and disease risks in trade in any species. But they're coming under increasing scrutiny to potentially expand their focus to start incorporating some of the health and welfare issues that need to be addressed in trade. We all know that when any wild caught animals are traded, they're usually kept in smaller enclosures. Stress levels of these animals, not in all instances, but in many instances, increases. They're very often kept in multi-species enclosures. So the chance for disease outbreaks or for diseases to arise or to cross between species is definitely there. And it's a question of how is this going to be dealt with under CITES and by the world. The next question is, how are countries around the world, but in this particular case across Africa, how are they going to deal with the coronavirus and our future and what it looks like? And how are we going to reduce the risk of this happening again? We know that when governments are motivated, it's amazing how much can get done. And all one needs to really look at is taking terrorism, for example. The amount of money and the resources that governments and countries around the world have put into fighting terrorism has been incredible. And yet in 10 years, fewer people have been killed by terrorism than have been killed by the coronavirus in a month. So it's just, and it just shows you when governments put their mind to something, what can happen. And it would be fantastic to see that same sort of commitment to reducing the risk of this happening again. And there's been a lot of talk too about how do we do this and what does that look like? And legislation is hard to put in place. It takes a long time to put in place, but there's real opportunity now to be creative and to look at treaties and MOUs and policies between countries and a lot more collaborative working together of countries across Africa to combat trade and the risk associated with it, whether it's in the form of meat and products or whether it's in the form of live wild caught trade. So what are our immediate next steps? The first thing is that we need to reduce the crane trade. We need to reduce that risk. And cranes are potentially an ideal flagship for a host of other bird species that are involved in trade, a host of small mammals and reptiles that are also being traded for the live pet trade or live captive trade around the world. Is this an opportunity now for us to use cranes as a flagship, a species that is easily identifiable, to actually bring in under this umbrella all those other species of a similar size and smaller that are threatened now by the illegal wildlife live captive trade? Focusing a little bit more onto cranes themselves, as I've mentioned earlier, we need to understand the demand sector as it currently stands. We've heard a lot of rumors about large flocks of cranes in safari parks and water parks across the Far East. Is that really the case, or is it rumors from one or two? We need to get a better understanding of what is happening. We need to keep abreast of market chains and understand where they are now and how they are changing over time. We need to ensure sustainable captive populations around the world. Zoos and captive facilities want to have cranes on display or want to keep them in collections. And this is possible if we have viable populations which breed effectively and there's no need to go to the wild to take wild caught cranes for these captive populations. We need to reach the captive facilities that are not registered and organized at this stage under those formal zoo associations. And we need to find a way to do that. And we need to understand and overcome the barriers to law enforcement at the national and international levels. Like, for instance, come up with an innovative and creative solution to addressing trade at the border posts and find a way that we can actually make sure that confiscations happen, but that the cranes and the other species that are confiscated actually survive survive the court case and effective solutions can be found. But it goes far broader than that. And I touched on it when I was talking about COVID. It's the increasing and the closer contact between wildlife and or animals and people that increases the risk of zoonoses emerging. But I believe very strongly that there is a balance. I believe that people and cranes and wildlife can coexist. I believe that we can do that in an environment where the risk for transmission of disease is low. I believe that we can exist optimally where both people and cranes and other biodiversity benefits. It's a question of finding out what that balance is, what it looks like, and then working together to make that happen. And that includes very strongly our ecosystems and making sure that they are functioning well, that the vulnerable communities who are so impacted upon by disease, by weather or economics can. So it's about finding that balance in the environment. And I want to end with this fantastic piece by Sir David Attenborough, which says that cranes are magnificent dancers, international travelers, and great ambassadors for conservation worldwide. What birds could be more deserving of our help and protection? And I hope through this talk you have a much deeper sense of the amazingness of cranes, about their beauty and their charisma, and about the efforts that are underway now to make sure that it's that very beauty and charisma that they hold that doesn't become a key threat to their future existence. I want to open it up to questions now. Clay Morandi, who works with me at the International Crane Foundation, and Tanya Smith are behind the scenes helping to answer questions. And Tanya has managed to gather up a couple of questions as I have been talking. And she will now be joining me and asking me some of those questions, two or three of them, that have come up during my presentation. Tanya Smith works with me. She is based down here in South Africa, and she heads up our South African region under the International Crane Foundation Endangered Wildlife Trust Partnership. Thanks, Tanya.
Cool. Thanks, Karen. And hi, everybody. Yeah, nothing quite like a few hiccups to keep things interesting, Karen. So, sorry about your internet connection there. And for those that stayed on through us trying to overcome those technical challenges, thanks very much. And thanks everyone to posing some of your questions. So I'm going to kick off, Karen. We've had a few questions along the lines of really people trying to understand how do we actually gather this kind of information that you were referring to in your presentation. Specifically, how do we collect information on the number of cranes, who's taking them out of the wild, where are they being held? And, you know, how does one go about it? Do we actually meet people that hold the cranes? Or is this through reports from various community members that speak to us? If you could just give a bit of feedback in terms of how an organization like ICF and EWT and potentially government agencies go about in gathering this information, because obviously without the information and the data, we find it hard to obviously act and address this key threat.
Great. Thanks, Tanya. And that's a great question. And I think is really key to everything, to all of the information that we currently have. And it's really through a number of different approaches. I think it is through informers, so through relationships that we have built with people who trade in cranes, who keep cranes, or who know of people who trade in cranes, who provide us with the information. So it is through informers. It's also through just general conversations that we have with community members and stakeholders who live in the areas where cranes are potentially taken out of the wild, or at a point where there is a point along a crane a market chain. Where people provide us with information, and very often it's always given to us voluntarily in all of the work that we do, but it very often just comes up in conversation. But in some instances as well, it's more targeted. So trying to better understand perhaps threats to cranes in an area within the topic of illegal trade will come up, and we can then discuss that a bit further. And in some instances, yes, we have used undercover operations in some areas where we know that there's been a really big problem and we just haven't known how to get to the bottom of it. So in some areas, yes, we have used undercover operations. So it's been a combination of different methods that we have used to come up with this information.
That's great. And I think, Karen, linked to that, obviously, generally speaking, it's the people that are in close contact with cranes that have the biggest impact on cranes in terms of crane trade and removal from the wild. We have a few questions here really around how do we provide alternatives to people and community members to try and stop people removing chicks from the wild. Obviously, it depends on the motivations. You explained really nicely that sometimes the motivation is for domestication, which is a pet. But other motivations are around selling it on as part of a trade process, whether that's domestic trade or international trade. So could you just provide a couple of examples for those that are listening around how as an organization and partners in the various countries are providing alternatives and trying to address the threat, which is the first action of removing the birds from the wild in the first place?
Thanks, Tanya. And another great question. And this is a very challenging one because it's, I think the big thing here is that we haven't necessarily in any of our approaches wanted to directly approach the people illegally removing cranes from the wild and providing them with a set of benefits. Because what that then does is encourages others who are also looking for benefits or for livelihood options to then want to go and take cranes so that they too will get the benefits. So really what it has been in all of our work has been about taking a community or a landscape level approach to conservation and to community development. So we have really looked at communities as a whole and looked at what the needs are within a community as a whole, and then worked with communities in terms of livelihoods and improving conditions, for example, providing clean sources of water and other benefits to communities where the community as a whole benefits. In that say, at the same time, no doubt there are some traders who get benefits, but they're not specifically targeted in the work that we do. In addition, we have highlighted a number of what we call crane custodians, who are real champions for cranes and for crane conservation. They're our eyes and ears on the ground, and we really appreciate them. We highlight them, and we make it public as to who these people are, and really incentivize them to keep monitoring cranes and keep everybody else in the community aware of these people who have been given this custodianship to look after cranes.
Excellent. Cool. Thanks, Karen. I think linking quite nicely onto that, you raised through your presentation, and it's come up in some of the questions here as well, is some of the barriers to addressing crane trade, specifically around law enforcement. And we have a really great question looking at, who's responsible for law enforcement in the countries specifically, but also at the borders when cranes are confiscated. Is there a role for an NGO and government partnership in addressing some of the barriers to crane trade, specifically the example you used of, where are birds kept when they're confiscated?
Absolutely. I think the mandate of law enforcement is often spread. Every country is slightly different, but the actual mandate is given to usually the government wildlife agency, but also the customs officials and those people who are at the border itself. So that's where the official mandate sits. But I think that there's a huge opportunity for NGOs to play a role here in bringing government departments together from different countries, to bringing the various law enforcement agencies within a country together, and to really exploring ways to unlock those barriers and to find a way forward. So I think that there's a huge opportunity for a multi-stakeholder approach to this, and to really helping the government find ways forward and solutions to these barriers where necessary.
Yeah, I mean, I think we've got Rwanda as a very nice example of where the NGO stakeholder and government agencies working together can make a massive headway in addressing crane trade within Rwanda. So,
yeah, absolutely. That's an ideal example.
Yeah. Cool. So I know we are running a little bit late, and we have extended the question time and the presentation time just to account for the technical difficulties. But Karen, I'm going to end off with a last question here, and it's really great that it did come up as well from our participants. But to kind of end off, like how can someone, whether it's a member of public, whether it's another NGO stakeholder, but how can someone help ICF and ICF EWT partnership and in-country partners stop crane trade? What can they do to help address the threat, to help obviously crane populations and a stunning species that grey crown cranes are? What do you have for them in your thoughts?
Tanya, there are so many ways that people can help, but I think first and foremost, we need to remember that ICF is a donor-supported organization. And the best way you can help is either to become a member or to become a member, or by donating, by going to our website, www.savingcranes.org. If you want to specifically contribute to the crane trade project or to grey or black crown crane conservation, you need to just indicate that in the comments on the online donation form. So that's an immediate way somebody can help. But I think more broadly as well, I think so many people around the world visit zoos, visit captive facilities, And I think if there is more pressure on captive facilities around the world to look at managing their cranes properly, making sure that they are kept under good conditions and are part of an organized program that looks at viable captive populations, it really is the ideal. So I think what I would like to urge everybody to do is just start asking those questions, because I think the more people that ask about the management of the birds and asking whether they're wild caught or captive bred, or, and if they are captive bred, where did they come from, we'll increase the number of people who are aware of this threat and hopefully reduce the number of wild caught cranes going into captivity around the world.
That's perfect. Thanks, Karen.
Thanks.
I think remind everyone of the great talks that are coming up, and yeah, thanks everyone for fielding the great questions. And yeah, enjoyed it. Well done, Karen.
Great. Thanks. Just to finish off, I just want to say again, a big thank you to our fields from the field sponsors, Kathy and Rick Fox. And as Tanya said, remember to join us for our next From the Field webinar. Tran Tritt, one of my colleagues, is going to be giving a great presentation, I know, on a very innovative project looking at impact investing of cranes in the rice zone, and looking at how you conserve cranes in an agricultural landscape. So I know it's going to be a very exciting talk, so please don't miss that. And this presentation and our work is made possible by the support of people like you. And I really want to thank everybody who's been on this call and in on this presentation. I do apologize profusely for my technical issues there. It just happens at the worst time. So I do apologize for that and appreciate you staying on. And please consider making a gift or becoming a member of the International Crane Foundation at www.savingcranes.org. Thanks everyone, and have a good day.